Hello, my name is David Marar. I am a data policy fellow at New York University. Thank you very much to everyone for joining us and welcome. Today's event is called Surveying the Hybrid Speech Governance Landscape. I have with me four great panelists. They are Chris Riley, Senior Fellow, Internet Governance, R Street Institute, Rachel Wolbers, Head of Global Engagement Oversight Board, Natalie Marischal, Policy Director, Ranking Digital Rights, and David Sullivan, Executive Director, Digital Trust and Safety Partnership. So a quick intro. What is hybrid speech governance and why are we talking about it? Hybrid speech governance refers to governance mechanisms on speech where the main actor is not government. It doesn't mean government can't be involved, just that other stakeholder groups are as or more important. Of course, we're talking primarily about online speech and the governance of those spaces. The early ethos of cyber libertarians of the internet as a realm with little encroachment from governments around the world can still be seen today on the technical layer, where standards, rules, and enforcement are done not by states, but through multi-stakeholder institutions, where industry, civil society, and academia, along with representatives from governments, work together to ensure the internet works. However, what we call the internet, web pages, online platforms, social media, ads, et cetera, that we use regularly, there's a different situation there. Around the world, governments are enacting regulations and policies to enshrine responsibilities and rights, as well as mechanisms for accountability and recourse. However, in the United States, the government is not allowed to regulate speech beyond its very narrow remit that judicial precedent has created. Enter hybrid speech governance, where other stakeholder groups, to an extent, pick up the slack. Today, we're discussing three such mechanisms, one that is specific to a company, but whose actions are decided by experts from civil society, another that is industry-wide, and a third that convened industry and civil society to start a dialogue and define perspectives. So with that intro out of the way, my first question goes to Rachel. Rachel, can you please explain in sort of general terms what the Facebook or Meta Oversight Board is and how it functions, where you see its role in the general hybrid governance framework as well?
Yeah, thank you so much, David. It's so great to be here. I'm really excited to see everybody on the screen. And I think, David, you actually set it up really perfectly. And I joined the staff of the Oversight Board. I run all of our engagement with stakeholders and outreach almost 2 years ago, actually. I'm a few weeks shy of 2 years. And the reason I had joined was after working in the government and in DC for almost a decade on content moderation issues, it's really hard for the government to truly regulate in this space, particularly the American government. And I've always been a fan of experimenting and startups and new organizations, and decided to come over to the Oversight Board. So the Oversight Board set up in, we launched officially in May of 2020. We started hearing cases in October of 2020. So we've been operating really for users for about 18 months. And so there are two ways that people can appeal cases. First, Meta can ask the Oversight Board if a piece of content or a broader policy around their products and platforms should be taken up, left down, or these broader policy recommendations. So the company can refer cases, but really what we're seeing is users can also appeal cases. And we just announced last week our first annual report that goes through everything that we did in our first year. We had over a million user appeals. And so when you, a user, feel like your content was either taken down or somebody else's content was left up that was in violation of the terms of service or not in line with the terms and conditions, and they're different for Facebook and Instagram, so you can then appeal, and the board selects a very small number of those cases, outsources that to this group of now 23 independent experts. They're actually all sitting directly above me right now. We are meeting for the very first time in the 2+ years. So it's really great to have them all in a room and meeting each other and learning a lot about their backgrounds in human rights and law and academia and activism, and bringing together this really interesting group that then will issue these binding recommendations. So what the Facebook and Meta have done is essentially delegate power to this group of 23 people who can, in a very few number of cases and pieces of content, can make binding decisions and also issue policy recommendations. I've heard cases from all over the world. Notably, was the case related to former President Trump's Instagram and Facebook accounts. And then we're currently working on a big policy advisory opinion around Meta's secondary review process, which is generally referred to as cross-check. So those are some of the highlights. I'm happy to answer a lot of other questions. But, you know, as David mentioned, this is really a new way of thinking about how a company can have content moderation rules designated to an outside entity that's not government or an industry association. So we're kind of our own little unique social experiment that hopefully people think is going as well as can be expected, decent. So that's me, and I'll turn it over to whoever is next.
Thank you, Rachel. I have David. David Sullivan, can you tell us a little bit about the Digital Trust and Safety Partnership and how it came to be, about its members, potential goals, stuff like that?
Sure. Thanks, David. And thanks to you and our street for pulling this event together. It's great to be as part of this panel and really looking forward to the discussion. So the Digital Trust and Safety Partnership is a new initiative that launched in February of 2021, which I joined as the executive director in August of last year, that's dedicated to a safer and more trustworthy internet. And so maybe just to back up for 2 seconds to something that I think everybody here knows, but it's always, I think, nonetheless worth stating, is that, you know, the very diverse array of digital products and services that are being offered out there have sort of kept us connected and getting educated and entertained during this pandemic. We rely on these tools. They provide an enormous amount of value. And I think that's always worth saying. That said, as everybody knows, digital services from, you know, social media to e-commerce, to search engines, to what have you, all can be abused and misused by all sorts of bad actors for all sorts of nefarious purposes. So the companies that formed the Digital Trust and Safety Partnership were up to 14 companies now, including players as large as Meta and Google and Apple, but also smaller players like Discord and Reddit and Bitly. We've come together around the need for industry best practices for trust and safety. So trust and safety is a term that people may be more or less familiar with, depending on how close you are to the industry and whether you know lots of people who are working in this field, in which case your LinkedIn feed is full of things about trust and safety. You may be even somebody working on, say, digital rights or, you know, content moderation or social media, but may not have heard the term trust and safety. So this is really the function inside companies that's dedicated to addressing the risks to the users of this site or the service. And in some cases, these trust and safety functions have existed for, you know, 20 years or thereabouts. In other cases, companies are really just standing up these services. But it's a function inside tech companies, just like cybersecurity or privacy or other disciplines are. But it's one that hasn't yet formalized. And that's what we're trying to do at the partnership. So our members have committed to 5 overarching commitments to sort of take trust and safety seriously across different domains. So that's product development, it's governance, it's what are the rules for the service, how are those rules developed and explained, how are those rules enforced as the third commitment. 4th is how to improve over time. And 5th is the need for transparency with the users of the service, with the public, with other stakeholders. So underneath those 5 commitments, our members have come together and articulated 35 best practices that companies can use. And that ranges from, you know, incorporating trust and safety perspectives in teams, you know, in the development of products and product review, to things like having an appeals process, like Rachel mentioned before, And so you can take a look at our website to learn more about that best practices framework, which we're backing up with a system of assessment. So we published in December of last year something called the SAFE framework, which is our approach to assessing these practices. Our company members have just finished conducting self-assessments, and we're looking to build a process of independent third-party assessment of these practices. And the last thing I'll say now before turning it over to the other speakers is that our approach really has, I think, two central focuses, which I think also differentiate us from some of the other kind of initiatives in this space of content governance. The first is that, you know, we are very much a group of practitioners from inside companies looking to define some best practices for this discipline of trust and safety. So instead of taking a kind of normative, like what should be done in this space approach, we are taking more of a descriptive approach to say, what is it that companies are doing? And can we get companies that offer very different types of products and services to align around practices that can help manage these risks? The second thing is that in that focus on practice, we are not trying to get our company members to agree on the substance of what might constitute hate speech or online abuse and harassment or terrorism. Those are really complicated questions. Companies are going to take very different approaches to them. I think it's good for society at large for there to be different views of these things. But companies can agree to the practices that they can use to manage that risk. So that's the approach that we're taking, and I'm happy to talk more about it. Thanks a lot.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you, David. Next up, Chris. So, you know, not all hybrid speech governance mechanisms or institutions, some are convenings. Can you talk a little bit about the R Street convening that has already happened, what it was designed to do, and how to best sort of understand it as part of a general ecosystem?
Thanks, David. My pleasure. And thanks for organizing this all. Just a little bit more on me for those who don't know me. As David said, Chris Riley, I'm a senior fellow for internet governance at R Street. I've been working on internet governance for quite a while now, wearing a few different jobs and a few different hats. And at R Street, my focus is on content policy and governance issues, so very much the subject of what we're talking about here. It's really great to hear from Rachel and David in their opening comments and the still very new organizations they're both working with, contributing to this complex landscape of internet governance institutions and looking for creative new approaches, which the R Street convening is very much of that same mold and mindset, I would say. So I wrote a paper, and I promise I will get to the convening, don't worry. I don't have that long of an opening remark here. I wrote a paper 9 years ago now called Anarchy, State, or Utopia, a reference to Nozick for the political philosophy fans out there. And it was about checks and balances of power in internet governance. Internet governance is a complex system of levers. Once it was a social contract, it was small, it was informal, but then a lot of money came in, things got very big, and it didn't really evolve that way. Things changed a lot. So my motivation behind that paper was to say, it's not a question of more or less government. And none of these questions really are. It's far more complex than that, and the ways that these levers trade off of each other. So speech governance is complicated. And as David Sullivan alluded to, the time for pure self-regulatory governance is in the past. But at the same time, we've lost a lot of trust between stakeholders. Civil society and government actors don't have the same level of trust with industry as they did even 10 years ago. So in this context, how can we, stakeholders outside government, help government understand the richness of what's going on with content moderation in the private sector to help inform the coming speech laws and help them avoid undue harm? The R Street convening was meant to be a start of an answer to that. I think of it as a down payment on what I hope will be a future of rich multi-stakeholder convenings on content moderation and online speech. My goal through this project is bringing together platforms and their skeptics, some of their ardent skeptics, to discuss in real time some of the most difficult normative and practical questions in the field, the questions for which there aren't answers. We don't know the answers to these questions. And then prepare a report based on that discussion to help illustrate some of the shared understandings and some of the issues where there isn't any sort of alignment, just to help show that complexity and that richness. So we talked about a lot of things in that, like the role of automation in content moderation. At scale, I think most view automation as a very necessary piece, but it very much has its challenges as well. So I wanted to help us work to understand the value that moderation can offer, as well as the challenges inherent in that. A similar challenge exists with transparency of content policies. So if you offer a very specific content policy, it becomes very predictable for a user, for a business to know what will happen, but then it becomes fragile at the same time. And it becomes easier for people to gamify or to try to circumvent those limits. So the goal of this effort, sort of to take a half step back, was to try to up-level the policy knowledge and the substantive awareness on these issues when all too often they're just being debated on grounds that are really more political and power-oriented and not evidence-based or analytical in the nature of the conversation. We also wanted to bring stakeholders together in a forum separate from a government proceeding, just in case there were any direct benefits that could be gained. Sometimes a little bit of mutual understanding can help institutions see around their natural myopia or their blind spots and make some benefits without obviating some forms of intervention that might be needed. I'm not saying there's any realistic probability of eliminating the need for legislation or intervention here. The space is just too hard and the differences are too great. But some sort of co-regulatory model, like the kinds of convenings, like the institutions that are on space today, all of the hybrid speech stuff that this event is about, if we can close the gap a little bit, then the role for government intervention is narrower and the mistakes and the error windows that can come inadvertently as a result of that become smaller too.
Fantastic, thank you. Thank you very much, Chris. And finally to Natalie. So, you know, you've heard your previous speakers talk about three sort of significant examples. And while ranking digital rights isn't necessarily one of these sort of structures, it does fulfill an important function for the speech governance ecosystem. Can you speak a little bit about on that and sort of about the state of speech governance, you know, and specifically what its most important needs are as we're looking towards the future?
Sure, David. Thanks for the softball question there. So for those of you who don't know Ranking Digital Rights, we're a research and advocacy program hosted at the New America Foundation. And our main activity is that we produce what's called the Corporate Accountability Index and a series of scorecards that evaluate companies in the big tech sector and the telecom sector as well on their respect for human rights. And both of their users and of the communities and the societies in which their users are members. So everyone, basically. And we focus on three core aspects. One is corporate governance. The second is freedom of expression and information. And the third is privacy. So today I'm primarily going to talk about our freedom of expression and information work, though there's of course a lot of overlap because all these dimensions overlap and reinforce each other in a bunch of interesting ways. So our latest report which came out this spring is called the 2022 Big Tech Scorecard. And I'm gonna drop a link here. And we have 14 global digital platforms here that we evaluate based on how well they meet the standards that we've set. And these standards are grounded in an international human rights framework, and they were developed over the course of years of research and consultation with experts in technology and human rights and in freedom of expression, in this case, around the world. So each of these 14 companies has a scorecard. So here I'm dropping you the link for Twitter, which achieved the first place in our scorecard this year. With 56% of points possible. So I don't know about where you all went to school, but this is not a passing grade anywhere I have been educated. And that's quite a few places because, well, I'm a geek. So, you know, Twitter's the best of the worst, but I'm really just sharing that as an illustration of what kind of things we're looking for. And so there's a bunch of different indicators on which we score each company. The kind of the most basic one here is access to terms of service, which we use kind of as a catch-all to also include content rules. So the Facebook community standards or the Meta community standards would be something that we look at here. So as you can see, we got a few hundreds, a few 90s, a few scores above 70, and then we have, you know, but even the lowest scores are in the 50s. So companies are doing relatively well at saying what their rules actually are. But then you look at the rules for how they actually enforce the disclosures for how they actually enforce those rules, and all of a sudden you get a lot less transparent. So that's starting to get a little bit dodgy. Then, you know, you wonder like, okay, so how many accounts are they actually actioning in relationship to these enforcement processes? Do we know that? And I'm trusting the audience to click here because screen sharing also always causes nightmares. And here it's looking pretty grim. The highest score there is 50% out of possible points, again, for Twitter. And it goes down from there. So you're like, gee, this doesn't look like they're particularly good at this. I wonder if there's an appeals process where people can say, hey, you took down my content, I have no idea why, or you're claiming a rule that's because of a rule that I don't see how this relates to this, or conversely, I reported this person for threatening to rape and murder me, and somehow you're saying that it's not against the rules of your company. Can I appeal? Well, no, not really, or at least it's hard to find information about how. The highest score here is Meta with a paltry 33% of points possible. And it kind of goes down from here. I'm not going to take you through the whole scorecard. The last one I want to look at, though, is one that we introduced, not with this report, but the previous one, which is whether companies do an impact assessment on the processes for policy enforcement, right? So we know from you know, among other things, the Frances Haugen disclosures that companies really vary, well, in this case, the Haugen case, Meta specifically varies really widely in how well it enforces its rules depending on the language the content is expressed in, among other things. And so that raises really important questions about equity and fairness. And, you know, are these rules actually rules if they're not enforced, or are they just public relations, right? And so if you look there, Meta does come in a respectable-ish second place behind Yahoo, which, believe it or not, still exists. But it's still only 33%, right? So there's really no evidence that companies across the sector are actually thinking about, thinking about the human rights implications of the uneven enforcement of their policies as they relate to speech. So what does this tell us about the topic at hand here, this question of hybrid speech governance? So for me, the main takeaway here is that we are nowhere near the point where companies can credibly say that we're at risk of having too much transparency and that the success of transparency is going to result in bad things. Conceptually, in theory, I agree with the point that Chris made, that there is a certain point at which transparency becomes unhelpful. We are nowhere near that point, right? We need a lot more transparency and a lot more accountability. The second thing, and this really speaks to the governance indicators that I mentioned but haven't gone through, is that the initiatives like the Meta Oversight Board are definitely interesting, right? From an intellectual perspective. But you know whose job it actually is to hold Meta accountable for its decision? It's its actual board of directors. Like, that's actually written into US law through the Securities and Exchange Act and so on. And there are actually human beings who make lots of money to sit on the board of this company to hold its leadership accountable for the decisions that it makes, not only in terms of whether it's managing the finances of the company correctly, although that's certainly part of it, but also what about the impact on the environment, on society, what legal risks and reputational risks the company might be exposing itself to, and therefore what risk it might be exposing investors' investments to, right? And this is where there's just no accountability whatsoever. And the reason for that, of course, is that Mark Zuckerberg is not only the founder, the face of the company, the CEO, but also the chair of the board of directors, right? So if you're keeping track, that means he's accountable to himself. That is not actual accountability, that's accountability theater. And in addition to that, because of the dual share class under which Meta was created when it launched its IPO, he can, despite owning a much smaller proportion of the shares, he controls more than 50% of the votes at a company's annual meeting. And in a minute, I'll drop a link to some analysis that my colleague Jan did about this dynamic. So all of this together, what the conclusion that it leads me to is that these kinds of conversations around hybrid speech governance are very intellectually interesting, super important in the long term, because even after we fix all the corporate abuses of power, we will still have these questions of how to govern speech. But I don't think speech governance is ultimately fixable at all until we solve the corporate accountability problem. But to be clear, it is important to continue having these conversations on one track, while on another track, impatient people like me are for fighting the corporate accountability fight, because when I win and my allies and I win, we will still need to figure out how to govern speech absent the unaccountable corporations that currently are preventing us from making any progress.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you, Natalie. Thank you all for these great answers to start us off. Do we at this point have any questions from panelists to each other? And so, you know, to our audience, we will feel free to sort of add your question in the Q&A, and we will get to it towards the end of the event. But if any of the panelists have any sort of, you know, rebuttals, responses, thoughts just from the opening conversations, please feel free. Going once, twice, three times, no problem. I have questions myself. So could the three of you that are talking specifically about an example of hybrid governance, sort of, could you discuss and highlight maybe some of the limitations of your own processes, right? Like talking through what the, you know, where it stops, how it can, you know, fail, all of these things. If either of the three of you can sort of like pick that up.
Yeah, I'm happy to go first, because I think the limitations were just so very clearly laid out by Natalie, actually. You know, the oversight board has a really limited scope. We're literally only looking at content that's been posted. We're not even have the ability to look at accounts or algorithms or corporate governance or like a lot of big media questions. And, you know, I think as an experiment, we had to start pretty small, right? And we're looking at pieces of content. However, you know, I get yelled at all day, most days, about Facebook's many, many problems. And, you know, there are other groups that probably like their board of directors and their shareholders and Congress who might want to fix some of these other problems. But the board is really, we are very limited, and it is, I like that Natalie called it an intellectual exercise, because it is very intellectual, right? We're writing 30 to 40 page decisions on one post and using international human rights law and concepts and principles in this very detailed and nuanced way. And I think that it is helpful for the broader understanding of how content moderation is working. We're trying to increase that transparency. But the board is really set up to be kind of a slow, deliberative, putting the human back into the loop content moderation process. And so there are challenges in just our own scope and our own authority, and then how slow we are. And I think David could probably talk to content moderation at scale, because that's not what the board is really doing. We're looking at one case at a time. I mean, I guess we're looking usually three cases at a time, but still a very small number of cases that is likely to have a very limited impact on a particular speech issue, although the broader policy recommendations, which are not binding on Meta, do try to speak to some of the bigger picture issues, but it's not content moderation at scale, which is what these companies are doing and should do. And it's definitely not all of that corporate governance that, again, I think it's really important to have groups like Ranking Digital Rights pushing on other parts of this, but we're all interacting in a pretty complex ecosystem here. And hopefully I've teed it up for you, David.
No, very well. And so, yeah, I would say turning to our partnership, I would say, you know, in terms of sort of the limitations and challenges, first, you know, it's no surprise that in an environment you know, as Natalie and other folks have ably described, bringing a group of companies together to define practices amongst themselves as practitioners is a challenging thing. And it's right and well for whether you're in government or in civil society or other stakeholders to be skeptical of a company-only approach. And that's one of the reasons why we are working towards having a credible, independent third-party assessment process for evaluating these practices that we have. There, I would say, there's also challenges and opportunities right now, and we'll get into this later, I'm sure. You have regulations that are being enacted in different places around the world, notably the Digital Services Act in Europe that actually calls for audits of very large online platforms practices in this space. And I have no doubt that on another Zoom webinar happening right now, folks from big accounting companies are marketing their DSA audit compliance programs to all sorts of companies. And there's a question about whether I think we have the right expertise in companies that do that sort of audit and assurance when it comes to the real practical details and substantive issues around online safety and digital rights and things like that. And I think we actually, one of the things that our partnership needs to do working together with the folks on this, as part of this meeting and other concerned stakeholders, is figure out how to create a body of experts who can meaningfully do this work and provide an objective, measurable sort of way of interrogating what's underneath the hood at companies. So I think Ranking Digital Rights does an incredible job of looking at the public disclosures of companies, but we also, there's a need to look underneath it, what's actually happening underneath the surface. We can do both of those things at once. Lastly, in terms of our constraints, I think the other one is that while Rachel and the Oversight Board get to deal with among the most kind of notable, like challenging questions that are on the front page of, every news site all around the world about whether or not, world leaders should be suspended from using social media services. When we talk about things like trust and safety practices, management system standards, it just sort of instantaneously causes people's eyes to glaze over, because we're trying to look at this from kind of a, management of the industrial oversight of content production, which is not the sort of hot button question around disinformation over here or child safety over there that grabs people's attention. But we need to push people towards understanding that these practices are how you can address these issues. That's what's happened in cybersecurity with things like the NIST cybersecurity framework. And it can be part of the solution, albeit just part of the solution. I think we need all of these other pieces as well when it comes to content.
I'd love to jump in on that if you don't mind, because there was a lot that was said that I thought was really interesting. I mean, the when you first said, David, sort of what are the limitations, I mean, the first thing that came to my mind was regulation and legislation, which I'm glad David got to that. Like, it changes a lot of things, and there's only so much that any of these different structures can do to help educate, to help inform, to help shape and so forth. But it happens, and it causes a big sea change when it does happen, and it in lots of different ways. I'll go back to my metaphor from the beginning. Internet governance is a complex system. Nobody can move every piece on this chessboard all at the same time, not even government. They can move a lot of them, but they can't move every piece. And so everything is limited. Everything is imperfect. It's an unsolvable problem at the same time, right? We're never going to get content policy, content moderation perfectly done, for the same reason we will never solve cybersecurity perfectly. So anytime any of these institutions can look back at what they've done and said, we have moved something positively forward in a way that feels sustainable, that is an incredibly good thing that we should all celebrate, right? I tend to use the phrase critical community as a sort of a shorthand for a lot of different people, institutions, and organizations that are trying to move a piece or two forward as they can. And I like to take a step back every now and then, just as I think we're doing today, and look at the set of them and not the limitations or the challenges of each one, but at what collectively they are doing together and the good that can happen. One slightly more concrete thing that I have seen through sort of our commentary, there's a split between normative influence that we're all trying to have and then sort of execution influences that we're all trying to have. And I think it's sort of useful to tee that up. I mean, the Oversight Board has been built so much for really helpful execution influence on the individual cases, also tries to do normative with its policy opinions, but these are very different strategies and very different tactics. And I think in David's in setup at DTSP, they're trying to do the same split too, right? Like, it's not that people try to focus exclusively on one or the other, but they do feel very different to me, and the limitations that arise from them are also very different.
Thank you very much. Natalie, do you want to jump in on this? No, oh, no problem. So, you know, sort of putting together what we talked about so far, I wanted to sort of skip ahead a little bit. Do each of you feel like these examples, these hybrid speech examples, are kind of based on our conversations about how, you know, they are connected to regulation and legislation, do you think they detract or do they potentially enhance government action, both in the United States and sort of abroad, everywhere else in the world, where there's already, like we've discussed, you know, there's already big name legislation happening that is changing the landscape a little bit? Is that a symbiotic relationship or is it more of a parasitic one? Anybody want to tackle that?
I'll go first. It's a complex question. And I'll go first and say, I'll give a shout out to Natalie and to Ranking Digital Rights. I think that the research and exploratory work that they do, that many other researchers do in the space, is a very complementary piece to governments who are working to try to understand the depths of problems going on here and where their interventions can have the most impact and the most influence. It's hard sometimes to translate the language barriers, right? Like, understanding research and the output of research and how that is supposed to influence things like the text of the Digital Services Act gets us squarely into the mix of this complex system. But research helps. Research helps a lot, right? Like, some of the work that my colleagues at R Street and that the other scholars within the Knight Research Network do adds a lot and is extremely complementary, necessary for government regulation to be effective.
I can add to that and just say that I think in when it comes to the type of initiative like the Digital Trust and Safety Partnership, definitely complementary and supplementary to the kind of regulation that is happening in many other places around the world. Whether or not any of it happens here in the United States is still an open question for reasons that, David, you mentioned in your intro and that we can get into more later. But I think, you know, one, if you look at even regulation that has already been enacted, say in Australia, who updated their online safety regulations last year, or the Digital Services Act, just to pick two places, those are intensely co-regulatory efforts where there are codes of conduct that are either to be developed by industry or developed through multi-stakeholder processes that are going to sort of set the rules of the world for a lot of what's expected of companies under those regulations. And I think there is value in having a common industry position and common industry approaches and practices that then regulators can link into. And that may not cover everything that a regulator wants from an online service, but if it goes a substantial portion of the way, and if we can have, I think, companies, governments, and others in the critical community, to pick up Chris's term that I like, with shared values and shared intentions coming together to sort of lay a groundwork, I think that's going to go a very long way because of the flip side of the content regulation wave, which is all of the governments around the world who are either using content regulation measures to restrict people's rights and freedoms, intentionally, or maybe haven't thought through their regulations particularly well, and where you can have unintended consequences that also could be problematic for human rights. So I think it's really essential that we sort of work together. Freedom House, I think, set of 48 governments that were, you know, proposing new measures on with regards to tech companies last year, I think half of them related to content, and I'm sure those numbers are going to go up substantially this year. So I think it's urgent that we all sort of get our act together and think about how these things can work together.
Yeah, I wholeheartedly agree. I think all of us on this call have, you know, worked on internet content moderation issues for a long time. And one of my biggest fears is definitely that different governments are going to create different regimes that won't be, that'll conflict or will be really, really difficult for people to communicate. Because I think that's why we all love social media or see the value of social media, to ensure that, you know, people in India are able to talk to people in Africa and in Europe and the United States. And the way that Meta, that Facebook and Instagram apply their rules is a global standard. So the rules that Americans have around hate speech are the same that people in Pakistan have. And I think there's a way to keep everybody up at a higher level. And I worry a lot about government regulation sort of dragging down or limiting speech in a way that would be, you know, really hard to do at scale, but also just detrimental to the goals that I think every one of us have towards having freedom of expression and respecting human rights and ensuring that, like, social media does still keep everybody together. So I hope that our regulators aren't going to, you know, ruin what's actually good about the internet.
I definitely share that sentiment that, you know, we don't want, no regulation is certainly better than bad regulation. And we've seen so much bad regulation and attempts at bad regulation, dare I say, earn it, that, you know, sometimes it feels, you know, being in the advocacy civil society space, it feels like you spend so much time whacking down all the terrible ideas that you don't have time to think proactively about good ideas. And that's really hard, right? Because it's not effective, and it's also not fun to be in the position of saying, no, that's bad, without ever getting to advance something else, right? The concern that I have about the conversation, and I'm gonna draw a little box about the conversation I mean the conversation about the voluntary moderation of non-commercial speech by private actors, right, is that it's a very important conversation. It's very thorny, and plenty of people can have and will continue to have very fruitful careers in a variety of sectors working just on that. The problem is that we tend to forget that there are other things that are also deserving of attention and where government intervention is perhaps much more obtainable and even more crucial. So I mentioned corporate governance. There's also privacy and data protection, which, you know, there is a nexus between privacy, data protection on one hand, and speech and expression and another, right? That's seen very vividly in the case of algorithms, which recommend and, you know, boost certain content based in large part on people's behavioral data as it's tracked and analyzed by companies, but also the regulation of commercial speech, which is ads, but also various other forms of paid speech, where even in a First Amendment paradigm, you absolutely can regulate, and we should be regulating, right? And there's a host of harms that are associated with advertising that could be addressed by law, but that are not being addressed by law. And I see a deliberate, this is how most companies in this space make most of their money, right? And at the level, at the institutional level of the platform, I see a deliberate play to steer the conversation away from the conversation about how do we regulate advertising, how do we address the harms that are associated with advertising, by keeping the conversation focused on a question that, as important and essential as it is, will never be fully resolved, right? For those of you who've read David Kaye's book, Speech Police, and if you haven't, you should. If you're interested in this topic, you have to read Speech Police. We will never ever get to a point where there's perfect content moderation and where everybody agrees, and we shouldn't, right? That should not be what we aspire to, but we can continue to work on making it better, but not at the expense of fixing the things that are really basic. So I won't go through and pull up all of my individual receipts, but you can look for them on the RDR website. I assure you they have them. Companies are pretty good at telling us what the content and targeting rules are for ads. I mean, they have to, because they have to have those rules for advertisers. So they make them public. Fine. They're even worse, but they do a terrible job of explaining how those rules are enforced. None of them produce any kind of information about the volume of actions taken against ads. TikTok actually last year published just a raw number, but you know, it's completely meaningless, right? With that, it's the missing denominator problem, among other things. Ads were explicitly carved out of the mandate for the oversight board, right? And I don't think that's an accident, right? I think if I could change one thing about the oversight board, it would be to put ads within both ad content and our targeting within its scope. I just think, you know, again, as important as this conversation is, I think there's a deliberate play by the industry to keep everybody arguing about a problem that can never be resolved, to stop us from looking at the golden goose and other golden poultry they may have clucking around, and that we might actually be able to make change that would make the world a better place, but also affect their bottom line.
Can I just jump in with one question there? And I have to say that that's my favorite image that I've heard in quite a long time, the golden poultry. But just on the point regarding advertising, I do think that there is another set of, there's another constituency that wields a lot of influence in this space, which is advertisers and brands. And that there is a conversation that's been going on around brand safety that's been happening largely adjacent to a lot of the questions about content moderation more broadly. And I think that there is an important need to try to bring those conversations together and see where there is consensus and where there's more that can be done, because I do think I worry sometimes about people from, say, the advertising world, with, for very understandable reasons, coming at questions around content and commercial speech and coming to conclusions that may be at odds with the views of a lot of folks coming from the digital rights and civil society world. Let's fix that and bring those folks together. I would also gently push back thinking about, you know, comments from Congress and members of Congress as to who is sort of, you know, pushing the debate around content moderation in which directions, but it's all really good points from Natalie.
You're totally right about the members of Congress. I'm my brain's not at full capacity. I'm still reeling from Friday, to be honest.
And to that point, honestly, I think we also have to think about when we talk about sort of the concerns about regulation, you know, we're now at a point where I think, you know, thinking about, you know, any particular type of regulation and how can it be, you know, sort of misused even in the United States, let alone other places around the world by bad actors within government, within different branches of the government. That's something that you know, companies need to be thinking through as they position themselves in this new world that we're in.
I think I saw Rachel on mute and I want to jump in too, but Rachel, do you want to go first and then I can clean up?
Yeah, I just have a sort of to Natalie's point about Friday. You know, we've been talking with a lot of stakeholders in the sexual reproductive health space, and there just does seem to be a huge discrepancy between, like, for instance, you can run all sorts of erectile dysfunction ads on Facebook and Instagram, but you are not allowed to run vaginal dryness or Vagisil ads. And so there is this, like, these ad policies are really opaque. It's really hard for me to understand. It's also hard for me to help people. I try to. Anybody on the call ever has issues with your Facebook or Instagram account, I can drop my email in the chat. But it's really hard when we're talking about advertising to really get a full picture of exactly what the rules are for those advertisers and how they're enforced. I know it's the same with broadly content moderation issues, but there's a whole separate set of standards around ads for Facebook and Instagram. And maybe the board was like triple the size, we could dive into some of those issues because there are a lot of them. So. My sexual reproductive health rant for the morning of like, there's a lot of unfairness here. So yeah, sorry, Chris, go ahead.
No, you're good. Thank you for that. And these problems are hard. We've said complicated so many times already in this session, but that's true of everything that goes with speech. It's worth recognizing it. I am glad that we're moving beyond blunt conceptualization of governance as either self-regulatory, too complicated, government can't touch it, versus government goes away in a black box and in its infinite wisdom passes laws that fix everything, right? Clearly neither of these is what we're talking about here. That's why this is called a hybrid governance conversation, right? That's right into the theme. I think that, and I hope that over time, a collection of processes and structures like this will allow us to fine tune how we approach the role of government, the role of industry, the role of auditors and independent audits and so forth on a more fine grained level, like differentiating between non-commercial speech and ads and platforms, which are different, right? Like Airbnb and other platforms like that are also subject to Section 230 protections in the US. And there's a reason for that, but there's a complexity there that's a little bit different than the ads conversation, which is itself different from the non-commercial speech, right? And separating out, I like how Natalie started that with voluntary, right? Huge gulf of difference between a content takedown that is because a platform has said this is against our policies and a platform that has received a notice from a government somewhere. But to the user, maybe there isn't. All they know is their content's gone, right? So these triggers are very different. And we need to have like a range of different kinds of structures that bring different voices together and have different processes. It's just going to take us a long time to build all of that. But I like that we're at least thinking about that and experimenting and building different systems like the ones on display today.
Thank you. Thank you very much to all of you on that. We're running up on a few minutes before the hour. We have a question from the audience that I'm actually going to blend a little bit with something that I already had down. But you know, we're clearly talking in a sort of a U.S.-centric perspective, right, and sort of this American exceptionalism point of view. And while other countries have already, like we've discussed so far, have already put out regulations, legislation. We are headed in the United States towards a midterm election this year, in a few months, and sort of to begin to wrap up our conversations, right? Given the political realities of the upcoming midterm election season, what do you think is the best way to achieve success broadly? However you define success. In terms of speech governance, and maybe particularly for each of your sort of organizations or processes that you're sort of representing here today. Who wants to go first?
I'm happy to go first because I also wanted to sort of respond or plus one Chris's last comment about trust and user trust in these institutions. And I think it does, it's really interesting. You know, I'm an American lawyer. And so when I think about government access to data or the government request to remove information, we as Americans are pretty privileged with the First Amendment. But there are lots of users, people who are on these platforms all over the world who don't have any faith in their governments and have even less faith in these institutions to truly protect their speech. So if I'm thinking about what we need to be successful or what does success look like, I think we need a lot more transparency around how the companies, not just Facebook and Instagram, but companies more broadly are working with governments and what sort of speech is being removed or even being left up. And I think that as we come into, honestly, the American midterm is important, but there are, I think, 7 or 8 really big elections happening in Africa. You have Brazil has a presidential election, Nigeria. There are places in the world where elections aren't just, the question about democracy, but really our life and death, and that you see a lot of violence around elections and misinformation. And so we do, the board has recommended several different crisis incident protocols. There are other organizations working on this. I'm sure David is too. So, but I know groups like the Global Internet Forum to Counter Terrorism, the OECD. So there are groups that are thinking about what are the right escalation mechanisms to ensure that problematic content is removed before it becomes offline violence or offline threats. And that's really what the oversight board's taking. Two cases from Ethiopia, one from Sudan, and two from Myanmar, one from India, that have all centered about offline violence and trying to really think about how these companies are having an impact on what's happening off their platforms, and how what happens on their platforms can lead to really serious harms outside of them. So my success, I guess, would be a little bit more transparency and a better understanding of how the platforms are working directly with governments that are not the United States government.
I agree with all that. And I see that as part of a broader agenda for, again, ending impunity and ushering in a new era of accountability for these giant corporations. And because most of the ones that we're talking about today were founded and are based in the United States, whether or not they get most of their income from the US or have their user base primarily US or not, it's a problem that started here and that's going to need to end here. I think the DSA and DMA are, you know, great, solid efforts. I'm very hopeful in terms of what they will be able to accomplish once they're in force. But things are not going to get better, however you define things and however you define better, for anyone anywhere in the world until there's corporate accountability for big tech in the U.S. And what the midterm and, of course, in the presidential election of 2024 really reinforced to me is that we have a really, really short narrow of time to get it done before we may not have any pretense of a democracy anymore in this country. And then it'll just be done. So I think in the short term, and this is a bit counterintuitive, in order to protect human rights everywhere, I think we need more US focused action, because again, this is not going to stop. All of the abuses, all of the harms are not going to stop until we have we bring some measure of accountability to US based companies. And this is something that for better or for worse, only the US federal government can do.
I can jump in after that. So I think one of the things that's really interesting, I agree, especially with Rachel's comments in terms of the international nature of these challenges, the acute challenges in conflict regions and places where there are risks of significant offline violence and atrocities. That's where I started my career working on those issues, and I've come back around to it here. And I think there is an enormous need to think ahead on some of those things, which is really what a lot of the practices that are part of the digital trust and safety partnerships best practice framework are aimed at doing, is getting companies to be proactive and thinking about these things and trying to prevent and respond to things. And also, this is a matter of not just waiting for regulation to come and complying with it, because especially in the case of the United States, we might be waiting for a very long time, but thinking ahead about what can companies do to address these things and to head off, you know, some of the serious, you know, reputational risks that companies are facing in this environment. For me, I think there's a couple things that in terms of what success looks like. So we want to share more information with all of you and with the world about what companies are doing, where they are more mature, where they are less mature, and where the industry as a whole can improve. And we're going to be doing that through reports that we're going to be putting out in the near future. But I think we also need to sort of stress test this framework that we've put together to see whether it works for companies in other parts of the world, and whether it works for companies in different places across this sort of digital industry. So that's why I'm looking to bring more companies into the partnership, companies in the sharing economy area, companies doing e-commerce, companies that may be, you know, at remove from the sort of, you know, social media ad-driven social media that is what is most on people's kind of radar screen, but where you still have really significant safety risks that need to be, you know, considered and addressed. So those are a few things that we're doing, but I tend to plus one all of the other speakers, which maybe comes as no surprise.
I'll jump in and start with a couple of quick plus ones too. To Rachel's point, lots of attention on elections and how we manage the spread of misinformation, disinformation in those contexts. That needs more than just focused on content takedowns. We need to be looking at how the role of recommendation systems and so forth as well. To riff on Natalie's point, certainly I believe there's going to be a lot of intervention to regulate corporate practices more. The question is how? And so the thing that I would like to see more of to reach success here, there's still a big gap between governmental and multi-stakeholder processes, whether we're looking at individual government processes. And here I'm thinking of the quiet trialogue brouhaha within the European Union institutions in the final days of the Digital Services Act negotiation, right? Like that was a messy closed process. And I don't like that. I like more inclusion and more sort of participation on that. But it's also true multilaterally as well, right? Like the Declaration for the Future of the Internet, objectively a good thing to have out there, but it wasn't inclusive. It doesn't have other stakeholders at the table. And so you look back at like Secretary of Commerce Raimondo and her confirmation hearings in the US, talked about bringing together stakeholders, multi-stakeholder convenings and processes led by the government, like the things that NTIA does so well. We haven't seen a lot of that. We've seen a lot of high profile Francis Hogan inspired hearings. That's not that those aren't useful, but that's not a substitute for the kinds of collaborative processes that need to have government as the wrangler in order to be really meaningful at contributing to that regulatory conversation.
Fantastic. Thank you all very, very much for joining us today. Thank you to our audience as well. This has been a great conversation on the hybrid speech governance ecosystem and the landscape. I thank you all again very much for joining and for sharing your thoughts and wisdom. And, I guess we'll see what happens in the future. Fingers crossed, at some point we'll be able to solve the things that are solvable and continue to talk intellectually about the things that are inherently insolvable. So thank you all very much again.
Thanks, David. Thanks, all.
Thanks, David.